Hello students, welcome to our channel physics class. Today we will study about LC oscillators. Do you want to learn about water oscillators? Do you want to learn what is the specialty of oscillator circuit? And do you want to learn how the combination of L and C, inductor and capacitor, work as an oscillator circuit? If your answer is yes, then this lecture is for you because you will get the answer of all of your questions. Water oscillator circuits, how do they work, how do the combination of L and C works, and what is the use and mathematical part. So all this we will learn in today's lecture, and it will be really interesting because by the end of the lecture you will be able, and every concept is clear to you, and you will be feeling much more confident about these oscillator circuits. So let us first begin with a circuit. This circuit you can see in blue color. Here we have a capacitor. So here we have a capacitor. These are the two charge plates of the capacitor with negative and positive polarity, and to this capacitor we have attached one inductor. Inductor is basically a coil. So these capacitor and inductor are connected, and as you can see in the circuit that there is nothing except the capacitor and inductor. That means we have not attached any voltage source, or we have not attached any battery or cell or any other component. Even we have not connected the key. So this L and C, this combination of L and C completely makes a circuit which we call as an oscillator circuit. Now first of all, what is the meaning of oscillator circuit? That means that the circuits which are given energy by themselves, they do not require any external energy source. So as you can see that to run the circuit, initially we provide some charge, and after that there is no external source for the continuation of energy transfer. So there is only energy transfer between this capacitor and inductor, and alternate energy transfer between capacitor and inductor. So they are self-conducting circuits, and the self-conducting circuits are known as oscillating circuits, which do not use any external voltage source. So how does combination of L and C. See here, like C is a capacitor. So first of all, we give charge to the capacitor so that our capacitor C is fully charged. That means what we are doing? We are charging our capacitor fully. Our capacitor is fully charged. So we have given whatever is the maximum charge to the capacitor that we have already given. Say small q is the charge we have given, and because this is the maximum charge, so we have written it as qm. So qm is the maximum charge we have given to the capacitor, and initially there is no energy in the inductor circuit. So initially we can write out the energy of capacitor and inductor. Now first of all, what is the function of a capacitor? The function of a capacitor is to store electrical energy. We charge the capacitor, then this energy is stored in the form of electrical energy, and then suddenly capacitor starts discharging. So it starts losing its stored electrical energy. And for the inductor, it also stores the energy. But for the inductor, the energy is stored in the form of magnetic energy. So capacitor stores electrical energy, and inductor L stores magnetic energy. So initially in the circuit, when the capacitor is fully charged, so the total energy is electrical energy. This energy we have written with a symbol U. And because the capacitor stores the electrical energy, so we have written UE. UE means the electrical energy stored by a capacitor. So what is the charge we have given? The charge we have given to capacitor is QM. So electrical energy will be, the formula for energy is U is equal to Q square upon 2C. Do you remember? If you have gone through the lecture, then you might have noted down in your notebook. I always instruct you to note down all the related formulas in your notebook, maybe in the back of the notebook. So what is the energy stored by capacitor? So here the charge is QM. So the electrical energy will be QM square upon 2C. And since initially inductor is not having any charge, so the energy of inductor, that is UL, that is equal to zero. That is in the initial condition. Now we connect this charge capacitor to the inductor. Why? Because we want to transfer some energy to the inductor from charge capacitor to the inductor. Right? So because we know if we have to make an oscillating circuit, then there should be alternatively energy transfer. So when we connect this capacitor to our inductor L, then the capacitor slowly starts discharging. That means charge will flow away from the capacitor and start going into the inductor. Now if the charge is flowing means current. So the charge is flowing from capacitor to inductor. So we call this flow of charge as current. Right? Try to understand once more that when we attach our capacitor to the inductor, then the charge flows from capacitor to inductor, and this charge flow we will call as the current I. So mathematically we can write down that at t equals to 0, initially we have given the charge to the capacitor Qm. So U is the energy of capacitor and UL is the energy of inductor. Now at any time t, when we have connected these two, there is a flow of current I, which is known as the flow of charge. So I is equal to dq upon dt. And because the charge is continuously flowing from capacitor to inductor, that means the magnitude of current is increasing with time. Because with time the charge flow is increasing, so we can say that the current is increasing, or the change in current will be positive. So di upon dt is equal to positive. Now we are transferring our current in the form of charge to the inductor. So we have taken two endpoints of the inductor. This endpoint we are calling as A and this we are calling as B. So this A is shown with positive charge and B is shown with negative charge. That means the voltage at point A is always greater than voltage at point B, because wherever the voltage is large, we write it with a positive sign, and where the voltage is comparatively low, we write it with a negative sign. So the two ends of inductor A and B are plus and minus. Voltage is large at A in comparison to the voltage at B. So this is plus and this is minus. So now we have made our oscillating circuit. This is a charge capacitor. It is transferring the charge to the inductor. Then there is an energy transfer. So if we want to write down the mathematical form, we can simply use Kirchhoff's loop rule, because we have formed a closed loop by connecting capacitor and inductor. So if we apply the Kirchhoff's loop rule, then that is a voltage rule. So what is the voltage drop at capacitor? It is always Q upon C, because V is equal to Q upon C. So the voltage drop at capacitor is Q upon C. And from this voltage, some voltage is taken by the inductor. Then what is it? That is in the form of EMF. That is again voltage. So what is the formula? LdI by dt. So we will write down Q upon C minus LdI by dt is equal to 0. That is from the Kirchhoff's loop rule. So from this equation we can write down minus di by dt plus 1 upon LC into Q is equal to 0. So we have taken L here. So it becomes minus di by dt plus 1 upon LC into Q is equal to 0. Now what is I? I is equal to minus dq upon dt. So just put the value as, because in the present case I will be minus dq upon dt. Put here the value of I, because I is equal to minus dq by dt. So minus minus will make a plus. So it will become d2q upon dt2 plus q upon LC is equal to 0. So what is the equation we are getting from the Kirchhoff's loop rule? d2q upon dt2 plus q upon LC equals to 0. And this equation is for a simple harmonic oscillator. You have studied the simple harmonic oscillator in our 11th class. Do you remember the equation? Yes, we remember the equation. It is very easy. D2x upon dt2 plus omega naught square x is equal to 0. So this is the equation for a simple harmonic oscillator. Any oscillator which is pursuing simple harmonic motion. So we are getting the equation for a LC circuit in the form of harmonic oscillator. That is why we call this circuit as a oscillator circuit. Right, because the equation mathematically comes out to be equal to an oscillating circuit. So here omega is the frequency of oscillation, omega naught we have written. So omega naught is the frequency of oscillation. So if you compare these two equations, then omega naught square is equal to 1 upon LC or omega naught is equal to 1 upon under root LC. This is the frequency of oscillation. Now we can write down a general equation. This equation is Q is equal to Qm cos omega naught t plus phi. This is the general equation for the charge. Now initially at t equals to 0, we have given all the charge to the capacitor. So Q is equal to Qm, that was the initial condition. And I is equal to minus dq upon dt. So we can write down, because we have the equation for Q is equal to Qm cos omega naught t plus phi. So if we differentiate this dq upon dt, then we'll get the current. So I is equal to Im sin omega naught t, and q is equal to qm cos omega naught t, because here we have neglected this phase difference phi. So these are the equations for the current and charge. So simply we have used the Kirchhoff's loop rule. And the equation we get in result, we have compared with the simple harmonic equation, simple harmonic oscillator, and then we can get the equation for current and charge. Now we want to see that how this combination of L and C, mathematically we got that this work as a simple harmonic oscillator. Now this, how this oscillator circuit works, so that it provides energy within the circuit itself. So let us go into the step one by one. So let us come to the first step. That means initially at time t equals to 0, when all of the charge is given to the capacitor only and no charge is going away from the capacitor, and inductor has no charge. So here the maximum charge that is given to the capacitor is Qm. So the electrical energy of the capacitor will be Qm square upon 2C, and the magnetic energy stored in the inductor is 0, because no energy is given to the inductor. So if you take the total energy of the oscillating circuit, then the total energy of the oscillating circuit can be written as U. So U is the sum of UE plus UB. So the total energy of the circuit is the energy of the capacitor plus the energy of the inductor. So the energy of the inductor is initially 0. So the total energy is equal to the energy of capacitor UE. So U equals to UE is equal to Qm square upon 2C. That is our first stage. Now let us go to second stage. Now in second stage, when we connect this inductor to the capacitor, then some of the charge starts flowing from capacitor towards the inductor. So we are calling this as flow of current I. So when the charge is flowing to the current I, then the energy is stored by the inductor in form of magnetic energy. And the charge of the capacitor is reduced because the capacitor is giving away the charge. So now it is not the maximum charge. It is having the value less than the maximum charge. So say it is having the value Q at any time. So what is the electrical energy? Electrical energy will be Q square upon 2C. Initially it was Qm square upon 2C because whole of the charge was with capacitor. Now capacitor has given away some charge. So it will be only Q square upon 2C. And where the charge has gone? That charge has gone to the inductor in form of energy stored in form of magnetic energy. And the magnetic energy is half Li square. This is again the formula of magnetic energy stored by any of the inductor. This formula is already known to us. This is a very famous formula. This is a very common formula for the magnetic energy of inductor. So UB is equal to half Li square. So in the second condition, u is having some value and ub is also having some value. So u is not equal to 0 and ub is not equal to 0. So the total energy u is the sum of ue plus ub. Now what will happen in stage 3? So in stage 3, the capacitor is fully discharged. Whatever was the charge as capacitor, that charge is given to the inductor. So now the capacitor does not have any charge. All the charge has gone in the form of current. So the current will be maximum. This maximum current we have written as Im. And since the capacitor is not having any charge, so the electrical energy stored in the capacitor UE is equal to 0. And this whole charge is transferred into inductor, or whole energy of the capacitor is gone to inductor. So now the inductor is having the maximum magnetic energy, half L Im square, because the current is maximum. So the magnetic energy half L I square will be maximum, half L Im square. So in this condition, the electrical energy in the capacitor is 0, but the magnetic energy in the inductor is half L Im square. So the total energy U is equal to UB is equal to half L Im square. Total energy will be equal to the magnetic energy of inductor because the capacitor is not having any energy. Now let us move to fourth stage, because now capacitor is having no energy and inductor is having all the energy. Now again, there is a flow of current from inductor towards the capacitor, and our capacitor starts charging because here the capacitor is fully discharged, and when it starts getting the charge, then it is in the charging state. So when it starts getting charge, again it will have the electrical energy. At if the charge is Q, then U is equal to Q square upon 2C, and the magnetic energy in inductor will be half L I square. So UE is having some value, UE is not equal to 0, and UB, magnetic energy in the inductor, is not equal to 0. So there is some value of UE Q square upon 2C and some value of UB half L I square. So the total energy U will be the sum of UE plus UB. So now in the fifth stage, that is equal to our initial stage, you can say. So now the capacitor is charging and charging and charging and charging, and the capacitor gets fully charged. So when the capacitor is fully charged, its energy will be half K A square, where A is the area of each plate. And in this case, the magnetic energy in the inductor will be 0. And what will happen after stage 5th? Yes, you're right. Then again the capacitor will start getting discharged. It will give some charge to the inductor. Current I will flow. Then here energy will be Q square upon 2C. And here it will start having energy half L I square. So in this way, the cycle continues from stage 1 to stage 5. And the energy is transferred from the capacitor to the inductor, and then inductor to the capacitor. Capacitor is charging, capacitor is charging fully, then it is discharging, then inductor is getting some energy, then inductor is having the maximum energy, then again inductor is giving some charge to the capacitor, and it starts getting charges. So this process continues, and we are having this circuit is self-governed. If the circuit is running by itself, there is not any external voltage, but there is a voltage transfer between the capacitor and the inductor. So that is why we call this LC circuit as an oscillating circuit, because any circuit which is not given with the external energy and it is energy is within the circuit itself, it is running this circuit by itself, then it is known as an oscillating circuit. And also the equation we are getting from the Kirchhoff's loop rule is similar to the equation of a simple harmonic oscillator. Now we know that why this is known as an oscillator circuit. So we want to compare this LC oscillator to a mechanical oscillations, how the oscillations of any LC oscillator circuit resembles to the mechanical oscillation. And what we do in the mechanical oscillation, simply we take a spring. This is a spring with a spring constant K, and one end of the spring is connected to the rigid end, and from this end we connect any mass small m. Then there are mechanical oscillation, there is alternately compression and expansion of the spring, and it performs simple harmonic oscillation, and the frequency of oscillation is omega naught. Then we can write down the equation for simple harmonic oscillation, d2x upon dt2 plus omega naught square x equals to 0. And here the frequency of oscillation for spring is omega naught is equal to under root k upon m, because k is equal to m omega square. Because for spring f is equal to minus kx, or f is equal to written as m into a, so m d2x upon dt2 plus kx equals to 0. So if we compare this, we will get omega naught is equal to under root k upon m, or k is equal to m omega square. So this is how we get the value of the frequency of oscillation. Mechanical oscillation is under root k upon m. And if you are using any inductor, then the EMF induced is minus L di by dt, and I is equal to Q, so it is equal to minus L d2Q upon dt2. So if you put the value, then for any of the LC circuit, so from here we get the frequency of oscillation as 1 upon under root LC. So we can say that 1 upon C is analogous to K. Whatever we are having K in the mechanical oscillation, F is equal to minus KX. And here we will have this is equal to K is analogous to 1 upon C, because K is equal to F upon X. And similarly, we will have 1 upon C is equal to V upon Q, because here the displacement X is replaced with Q. So due to the force, there is a displacement, and here due to the here there is a transference of charge. So we can say that K is analogous to 1 upon C. So we can also compare very easily our LC oscillator circuit or oscillations in any of the LC circuit to a mechanical oscillation. Now we have to know down two very important things for the LC oscillator circuit, that here we are considering as the perfectly oscillating circuit, but the inductor coil L, it has some resistance, and if it is having some resistance, it will obviously cause some damping effect. Damping effect means that our oscillations are not continuous in the amplitude. They are not of the equal amplitude. As the time passes by, the amplitude of the oscillation decreases and decreases. So due to the resistance of the inductor coil, our oscillation does not sustain to a long time. There is a damping effect, and the oscillation finally comes to an end. So although our LC oscillating circuit works as an oscillating circuit, but due to the resistance, there is a damping effect in the oscillations. Secondly, we can consider the resistance is approximately equal to zero. So if the resistance is approximately equal to zero, then the heat energy radiated I square will also be zero, almost equal to zero. But here the energy radiates away from the system in the form of electromagnetic waves. So there are energy losses. First, losses due to the resistance of the inductor coil. Second is the energy is radiating in the form of electromagnetic waves. So our LC oscillator circuit does not sustain oscillations to a very long period of time due to these two limitations. So we have to always note down these two limitations whenever we are considering about any of the LC circuit. So is it clear to you now how LC oscillation circuit is made, how LC oscillation circuit works, why we call it an oscillator circuit, and how there is an energy transfer between the capacitor and the inductor in each and every step, and how we can compare this to a simple harmonic oscillation, and how we can compare our LC oscillator circuit to any of the mechanical oscillations, and what are the two things we have to keep in mind whenever we are considering any of the oscillating circuit. So that is all about the LC oscillator circuit. Now you know everything about how it works, what is the principle, and what are the limitations, and what is the equation mathematically we can write down to define the LC oscillator circuit. So that is all for today. Then read this LC oscillator circuit. It is very interesting. And now you will be very much familiar with this, and you will be able to do all the questions, attempt all the questions related to LC oscillator circuit. Thank you.